Okay, Assalamualaikum. Selamat pagi. Good morning. Welcome back to the course SIG1005, Basics of Minerals, Rocks and Fossils. This is a first year undergraduate course, and this is practical number 3 for the fossil part, which I am teaching. Okay, so in the previous lecture, we looked at simple organisms. We looked at the unicellular protists. More specifically, we looked at those proteins with a hard test, radiolaria and foraminifera. Then we went one step further in terms of animal complexity. We looked at simple multicellular organisms in the form of the sponges, porifera, and slightly higher upwards in terms of complexity, the cnidaria, right? We looked at the corals. Okay, so this week we go to the next step to look at animals which are more complex relative to cnidaria, relative to corals. Okay, so we look at the superphylum Lophophorata. So notice in this case we are looking at a superphylum, not a phylum, but a superphylum. This is in the taxonomy, it is a higher rank, and below it there are several phyla. Okay. So for today's course, we look at the superphylum Lophophorata. So let's have a look at the characteristics of this superphylum. Right. So Lophophorates, we call them. They are more. If you compare them with the cnidarians, you're comparing them with corals, they are much more complex. First, they are bilaterally symmetrical animals. They have a right side and a left side. Okay, so humans are also bilaterally symmetrical. Compare that with the simple cnidarians, like the corals and the jellyfish, they are radially symmetrical. There's no right and left, right? It's, everywhere is the same. And in the case of the Lophophorates, you also have a well-developed head and a tail end. You know front from back. Okay, so you have a head and the back part is a tail. And with that, you have a one-way digestive tract. You have a mouth at the front and you have the anus at the back. Okay. So in corals, you don't have this. There is only one opening, both for the mouth and the anus. Okay. And one very distinguishing characteristic for the Lophophorates is the possession of a ring of ciliated hollow tentacles. They have these tentacles which are supported by a ring. They are hollow and they are used for filter feeding and also respiration. And this structure is called a Lophophore. Okay, so the structure gives the name to the superphylum. So all members of the superphylum Lophophorata have these tentacles called Lophophores. Okay, so superphylum Lophophorata can be divided into two phyla. So the plural for phylum is phyla, so two phyla here. First you have phylum Bryozoa. These are the colonial moss animals. So that's an example of a colonial bryozoan. And then we look at the second phylum Brachiopoda. These are the paired valve animals. They look superficially like clams, right? Cetira. So these are the two phyla, and both of these have Lophophores associated with their anatomy. Okay, so let's look at the first phylum Bryozoa. If there is a general name to them, people usually tend to call them moss animals. Okay. So for the layperson who is familiar with the sea, and you know things like corals and jellyfish, right? But say Bryozoans, not really that familiar, because although they are main important of marine ecosystems, it's just that they superficially sometimes resemble other things. You look at a thing like this, you might think that it might be a coral, has a calcareous skeleton. or it might be some people have also misidentified it as seaweed. Okay. Most these bryozoans tend to be very small, tiny really. The individuals of a bryozoan colony are called zooids. So that's a one zooid, that's another, and so on, right? All these are zooids. And their size is what? Well, around 1 millimeter long. So these are very small animals. Okay. But remember, they live in colonies, and the colony is called a zooarium. Okay. And these are also small. Most of the time, they're just up to 3 centimeters across. Although the largest ones can go up to 60 centimeters across. Okay. And they have a calcareous skeleton, just like corals. So sometimes you can misidentify them as corals. In terms of life habit, these are colonial animals. They are mainly marine animals. Okay. Although you have also freshwater bryozoans. But we're not really, that interested in the freshwater bryozoans. There is a better fossil record for the marine bryozoans. They are benthic animals, live on the seafloor, and most of the time they are attached to hard substrates in shallow waters. They form incrustations. Like, that's why we call them moss animals. They form incrustations on the surface of rocks, just like moss. Okay. All bryozoans are suspension feeders. They use their lophophores to filter out food from suspended material in the water. So, how do you classify the diversity of bryozoa? The classification is a little complicated. It's complex. And this is a first year course. I mean, we're not going to go into too much detail regarding the classification of bryozoans. I'll just show you examples. Bryozoa after this. You need to have some specialized equipment in order to identify the structures to classify them, because remember, these are very small animals. The zooids are just millimeter long, right? And the structures forming most of the structures that are used to identify them are less than one centimeter long, right? So you need a microscope, scanning electron microscope. You need to do thin section. So it's very specialized field. You're doing bryozoan taxonomy. But yeah, basically, the classification is based on the shape of the colony, the zooarium, and also of the individual rooms, the individual compartments for your zooids, which are called zooecium. The singular, plural is zooecia. Okay. So zooarium is the bryozoan colony. That's a single colony. That's another colony encrusting on a surface of a rock. Then you have the individuals inside the colony, which live inside these rooms. Right? And the rooms, we call them zooecium, or plural zooecia. So as an analogy with the fossil cnidarians, the cnidarians have rooms that we call corallites. Right? For a coral, the corallite. And the colony is called a corallum. So here, this is very analogous to your corallite. We call it a zooecium in bryozoans. Okay. Now, one thing about zooecia, you don't see septa. So that's one important character to note when trying to describe them. If you see a colonial animal with a calcareous skeleton, you look at the individual compartments, they lack septa. So you might say, maybe these are bryozoans. But I need to look into more detail, right? So, phylum Bryozoa is divided into these two classes. Okay? First, you have class Stenolemata, characterized by zooecia, which are long and tubular. That is, long and tubular. Okay, so, Stenolemata, long tubular zooecia. And then you have class Gymnolemata, where the zooecia are a little bit more complex, fancier, right? So, you have an opening for the zooecia, but inside it opens into a larger room. So they are like boxes. Okay. So you say that Gymnolemata has box-like zooecia. Okay, so phylum Bryozoa is divided into the Stenolaemata and the Plastinolaemata. Okay, so first we go to class Stenolaemata. Stenolaemata, remember long tubular zoysia. All these have long tubular zoysia. See, it's very long tubular here, right? It's divided into these three orders. First, you have Trepostomata, or the Trepostomata. General name for them is the Stony Bryozoa. Talk about why later. Or the Cryptostomata, erect bush-like colonies. And you have or the Cyclostomata, where your zoysia are long and curved. Okay, so three orders. So we go one by one. First, we have or the Treptostomata. Notice the age range. It is from Ordovician to Permian. Sorry, typo here. Ordovician to Permian. So these are extinct bryozoans. So how do you identify them? Well, it's a bit complicated. Let's just go through the general characteristics. First, you have zoysia, which have three different shapes. You have three different types of zoysia. Hard to see under hand specimen. You'll need a microscope. You need to do thin sections. Okay. Another thing, they have a shape which look like just pieces of rock. So there's a name for them. We call them stony bryozoans. Okay. These are also marine. These were marine organisms. They were benthic, colonial, and filter feeders, like all bryozoans. Okay. So the example here we have is Prasopora, which is from the Ordovician. And this is the zoarium. It's very small. Okay. And it's dome-shaped. The bumps here where you have the zoysia coming up. Okay, so second order in the class Stenolaemata. This is order Cryptostomata. Age range is Ordovician to Permian also. The characteristic. Now the zoaria tend to be erect. They stand upwards, or they stand proud. So you might have a surface here that grows upwards here. And they look like bushes, like plants. Okay? So with branches, with stems, and so on. But these are animals, remember? So they have erect, bush-like zoaria. Again, they are marine, benthic, colonial, filter feeders. Examples, the two well-known examples are very easy to identify. First, you have Archimedes. It has a screw-shaped colony. The spirals here, and here you see the individual zoysia on the margins here. Okay? So you have long tubular zoysia, characteristic of class Stenolaemata. So Archimedes has an age range from Carboniferous to Permian, or it's already extinct, as a screw-shaped zoaria. Then another easy to identify Cryptostomata bryozoan is the genus. Remember, these are genera, okay? So they are written down in italics. The genus Fenestella is Ordovician to Permian in age. The pattern is fine list-like, with a fan shape. Okay. So the white parts here are the actual skeleton. Okay. So remember that. And the dark parts here is just holes filled in with mudstone in this case. Okay. So you have smaller zoysia lining the skeleton here. Right. Yeah, so list-like, they look very fine, very fragile, and they are fan-shaped. So that is Fenestella. So then you have the next order is order Cyclostomata, still under class Stenolaemata. So you still have the long tubular zoysia. Okay, so the order Cyclostomata has an age range from Ordovician to recent. So they're not extinct, they're still around today. And they have long curved zoysia. For example, here you can zoom in. Those are the individual openings, right? So that's a long zoysia. That's like for all members of class Stenolaemata, but they are also curving. Right? Again, marine, benthic, colonial filter feeders. So I got one example to show you in Monia californica. This is from the Paleocene. The delicate branching of flat encrusting zoaria. Okay, now we look at another class, which is class Gymnolemata. So remember, for this class, the zoisia are box-like. So notice this, it's very clear here, right? They are box-like, where you have a small opening, but it when you go into it, it's a larger room inside it. Okay, so those are zoisia of the order of the class Gymnolemata. So just looking at one order in this case, order Calostomata. The age range is from Jurassic to recent. And just one example here, we're looking at Cosinoplura gigitata with box-like zoisia. So example here, that's the zoarium, the colony, and then you have the individual zoisia where the zoids lived. Okay, so this group is still around Jurassic to recent. Okay, so very simple for today's practical. Okay, we don't have much in terms of specimens. But the next group it's going to be more varied. Yeah? Look at the brachiopods, it's also members of the superphylum Lophophorata. Okay, bye.